Good morning.
Good
morning. So thank you all for coming to this year's debt panel at the 2016 TAP conference. You know, this year we're doing something a little bit different other than just, you know, the normal discussion on where we are debt, but I think our panelists as well, and hopefully the questions that we get, also are a bit more reflective of where we are 8 years post-downturn, or 7 years, depending on your math and where you're from. So with that, we'll start off with introductions first. I am Mahesh Iyer, and I work for City Community Capital, and I'm based here in Houston, Texas, and I kind of cover the market from Texas to Florida up through the Carolinas for City as a on the debt origination side, construction perm bridge, and also facilitate equity. Why don't I turn it over to Brian Jarvis? Brian, can you tell us a little bit about yourself?
Sure. Hi, I'm Brian Jarvis. I work at Bank of America. I am actually on the underwriter side, not the loan origination side, so I'm more of the mean counter that actually analyzes deals after they come in the door. I'm based out of San Antonio. I cover the Southwest market, which really includes everything over through Arizona, Texas, and Arizona, and some Colorado. Worked in a lot of areas of real estate. I've been in community development lending now for the last 3 years, and did a small stint with community development about 7 years ago for a few years as well.
That's right. Next time we got Ray Miller, right?
Yeah, good morning. Ray Miller with Capital One Bank, based in Houston, Texas. I've been with Capital One 15 years. I've been with the Affordable Lending Group for 8 years now. Capital One, we provide debt and equity products throughout our footprint. Primarily in Texas is in our major market. Houston is, you know, kind of home base for us, but we operate in all major metros and secondary markets, Dallas, San Antonio, Austin, the Valley, Beaumont, East Texas. And right now, you know, and Capital One offers a wide array of products. For the longest time, we've done primarily portfolio transactions off of our balance sheet, but recently, about 2 years ago, acquired an agency lender, and so we are now offering FHA, Fannie, Freddie products out to the market. So we're reintroducing this idea, I guess, through Capital One, and look forward to talking to everybody today.
And I'm Ken Overshine with Compass Bank, a lender based in Houston. Compass has about 700 branches in 7 states. About half of them are here in Texas, so it's a very important market for us. About 60% of our CRA lending needs to be done here in Texas. Compass had done some LIHTC lending in the past, then they kind of lost their way and were lovingly corrected by the regulators and told, you know, you need to get your CRA act together or you won't grow anymore. So about a year ago, we started ramping up the LIHTC program. I came over from another bank and have been there about a year, and so what we're doing is equity. We're doing construction debt and permanent debt, and equity we're doing as a sole upper tier investor through proprietary funds with certain syndicators, and then doing, as I say, kind of the construction to perm as a kind of a single close, one-stop shop. So as I say, you know, 7 states, 60% of us here in Texas, 20% Alabama, and then we kind of dabble in Denver and you know, California, Arizona, New Mexico, and Florida.
Good morning, I'm David Saling with Chase. I live here in Austin, so I'm a 10-mile commute to come down here for the conference. Through Chase and our other lending platforms, we provide construction permanent debt. We have LIHTC equity. We're a Fannie DUS lender. And pretty much operate coast to coast. We have offices in New York, Chicago, several here in Texas, Austin, Houston, Dallas, West Coast, ranging from Los Angeles up to Seattle, and pretty much cover the country out of one of those offices. We're more client-driven in that if we have clients that are in other areas of the country that we don't normally cover, we'll follow them where they go for the right deals and for good reasons. So But anyway, we look forward to talking with each and every one of you later today throughout the conference, and welcome.
And I think none of us get to cover Hawaii at all, do we?
No, but I raised my hand first. So
yeah, you raised your hand.
If Chase flies a branch in Hawaii, I'm raising my hand.
So we are being recorded, so don't get nervous. But if you do have a question at any time, please come up to the mic so that way we can hear it out pretty well. So let's hop into it. So one of the things that we're talking about 8 years post-downturn is we go through cycles down here in Texas. For those of you keeping an eye on the 9% allocation side and now on the bond side, as we went through the downturn, we generally had all the units that were in an application 100% affordable. That's migrated over the last number of years, right? You go from 100%, 90%, 80%, 75%,
50.
We have some clients that now do 50.
I got 50.
You know, got a client who wants to just do 2 units affordable. No, just kidding. So a key question that we're all dealing with in terms of taking a hard look at is, how do we underwrite mixed income these days, right? What point is it affordable deal versus migrating to a market rate structure? What does that entail in terms of underwriting characteristics, debt service, leverage, et cetera? So that's, I think, a good topical point that we'd like to maybe get into and get some thoughts on.
Yeah.
What
do
you got?
I'll take that, kind of starting off, because let's rewind the clock 8 years now, 8 years down the road. So primarily Houston is a great example. So you've seen a housing stock that's been 30, 40, 50 years old that really hasn't seen kind of an update in its housing stock in the longest time. So right after the mortgage crisis, you had the tendency shift from home ownership over to rental. So we've all seen the cranes over the past 7-8 years in all the major metros throughout Texas primarily. Houston, for example, is going to be delivering about 35,000 market rate units within the next two and a half years. So we've seen this influx of new housing product, hit the market. At the same time, too, we're also seeing, in the affordable industry, a new concept, taken by the state and HUD to incorporate, more of a mixed income. So you have these kind of two forces coming together at once. You have this massive hit of primarily, A-class product. You've seen a massive, increase in mixed income, hit the market. So as a lender, you're starting to weigh these out. So developers are seeing the benefits of it. They're seeing the benefits of rising rents. They've seen the additional NOI and having the ability to, source, additional loan and additional proceeds. And a lot of times it's needed. Construction costs are way up. Land costs are way up. All of these factors that are, that we're dealing with right now. So in the affordable industry, how do you wrestle, how do you grasp getting a pro forma that has 30, 40, 50% market rate component at this point? So I'm just going to take a step back and just say, as a lender, we are open to the concept because we know there is a need beyond just 30%, 60%. 80% now is an affordable range for a lot of people. We're talking about an income range that's not being served. Cities and HUD and just there's a lot of emphasis about putting more market rate in this kind of affordable, what we call discount affordable category. So when I look at a pro forma and I know I'm working in kind of a mixed income concept, we look for two things. One, that the affordable rents are obviously giving a discount to the general market. The market rates or unrestricted units that we're seeing in these properties as well, we're very cautious about where to hit those rents. So what do we consider an affordable, a discount affordable? Is it 10% discount to market? Is it 5% discount to market? That's one of the things we've been grappling where our comfort level is. Right now, I think we've been comfortable with at least a 10% discount to market. So if you're, if we determine a one bedroom market rate is $1,000 a month, and so we'd like to see at least a 10% discount on an affordable rent of at least $900 as a comparable factor. Some markets are a little different. You can shrink that gap a little bit. but it's something we're having to grasp and wrestle with more and more in each project that we're seeing nowadays. I don't know if anybody else has seen that as well.
Yeah, I'll just add a little comment to that. We it is typical for us to look at some kind of a discount to market for the market units, and generally 10% is adequate. But that's exactly the same kind of scenario that I think all commercial banks are going through on the mixed point.
Are you finding some markets are warranting even kind of a narrower, you know, where if you have a prime site in Austin or downtown Dallas, do you take that in consideration that might take a little narrower? Because that's what we're seeing as well, because we're seeing more dense units and in higher, you know, income markets. Mm-hmm. Do you take that in consideration?
Yeah, it's a tough sell, but yes.
Okay.
So what about LTV, debt service coverages? Do you make adjustments there aside from the rents?
On a market,
mixed use.
Yeah. We're not really doing anything different. I mean, we're doing the 115. The advantage of the market rate, even though you know there can be some disadvantages, the advantages, you're not really capped on what the rents can be. You know, so the rents will keep up with market much quicker than the LIHTC regulated rents will, and so that's one upside. One thing, I don't know if the rest of the banks look at it this way, but if you have a 50%, a true 50% market, 50% affordable, and you do the debt on that, do you guys count half of that debt as CRA? Because generally our rule is you've got to have 51%. And so we just need that little extra unit to make it 51%. Then we can qualify the whole loan on the debt side for CRA.
That's our threshold as well. Is that get that majority income, and for us, the way our regulators look at it, it's not primarily where the rents are dictated at. It's more about the tenant base. Yeah. So as long as we can verify that tenant base is at, I think, an 80% AMI or whatever that threshold is, and there's a lot of different ways developers and owners can document that. But a lot of times we like to see the rent regulation. But the 51% is kind of the magic ratio.
And so we're also doing some mixed rate, looking at some mixed rate projects that are mixed income that have 80% units. So 80% AMI workforce housing, the rest market rate. So we're making sure there's 51% at 80% so we can get qualification for all the debt that way. But it's an interesting product. There's a few, I think, NEF is one of the syndicators that actually will do equity investments into a workforce housing. They have a program for that. The secret sauce in that really is you've got to have a property tax exemption in order to hold all those units at 80% or less AMI. So the structure generally is that there's a housing finance corporation that owns the land, leases it on a 60 or 99 year lease to the developer, to the project, and in order to qualify for the exemption, that housing finance corporation has to have the right to basically buy the property anytime they want, or the right of first refusal. If the developer wants to sell the property, then the housing finance corporation has the right to buy it. So it kind of gives them an interest in it, which qualifies for the property tax exemption. So we're seeing some of that now. I think that, there's lots of 60% AMI units out there, but the 80 to 100% AMI is kind of tough to hit. Kind of wish the regulators would expand the definition of affordable workforce housing, something beyond 80%. But right now that's what we're stuck with is, 80% or less is what really qualifies for us. So we're seeing some of that as well. And in that case, we'd still like to see a little 10% if we can discount from true market rents to the market. I know the one deal I'm looking at, I think the market rents are about $1,300 on average, and the 80% rents are about $1,000 on average. So there's still a significant discount between the 80% and the market rents in that case. So I think it's a product we'll see more of and that we need more of.
So, let's circle back as it relates to that to debt service and LTV, because I think, on our end, we do mixed use at City, right? But we'll tend to look also what Fannie or Freddie will underwrite as well. Ultimately, one of the GSEs might wind up with them somewhere down the road. And generally, we're finding on mixed use product that it's instead of 115.90, there are some deals that on a selective basis, for example, Freddie Mac, like Texas is a good market for them, despite what you might see in energy. Freddie would like to be very, I don't want to say more aggressive, but yeah, definitely more aggressive, more open-minded on looking at deals down here. Texas generally, by and large, good economy. So they'll still do deals at 115, 90% LTV, but the standard is really 120, 85% or 120, 80% when you, you know, the more you get into that mixed use product, along with the discounted rents, right? So staying with 10, you know, having 10% below market on the affordable, but having decent market rents just to get in the conversation. And then from there, making the debt service LTV adjustments as we get through. Now, I think, just I'm assuming one of the things that we've run into, developer and I were talking to earlier this year, is when you step back and look in the affordable mix, we've had less than 1,000 units of affordable housing for such a huge state coming in on an annual basis since the downturn, right? If we're looking back, most of the bond product has not been opportune in this state, and now that's coming back, so we're seeing a mix. So I think probably going to Ray's point, while there's a lot of market rate product coming on the affordable component of that mixed use, the affordable absorption is still quite healthy, right? We've got a lot of pent-up demand on that. But
one comment, just in response to the LTV and debt coverage comment that you made. I have discovered that almost every deal, if not every deal I've looked at in the last several years, has been debt coverage constrained and not loan to value constrained. It's probably partially a function of the lower cap rates that we're seeing in the market, but I've found that really the debt coverage ends up being the threshold that, you know, governs the loan sizing.
I'm beginning to see, because markets outside of, say, Austin, or out of the big cities in Texas, when you go to the adjacent states where the cap rates are more down to earth, you know, then it winds up being LTV constrained. But you're right, in Texas, you know, Austin is what David, maybe like low fives?
And maybe if you go further out, you might get closer to six, but five and a half.
Five and a half cap common rates, yeah. That solves a lot of problems.
It does.
At least on the optics. One of the, you know, Texas has got 31 MSAs, right? Population centers over 100,000. So when we use the term small market around here, that has a lot of different connotations than if you were in other states. So a small market here could be, what, a quarter of a million people, a half million people in many respects. How have you seen the evolution in underwriting transactions in smaller markets, maybe say 100,000 people, maybe where you might only have one airline that might be flying in, if at all, to a local airport that might be 75 miles away?
You know, let's take like Lubbock. Yeah. You know, it's certainly bigger than 100,000, but it's its own little microcosm in and of itself. It's got a university, it has a thriving economy, it's not all oil, there's agricultural, there's ranching. You know, that's something that's fairly easy to underwrite in a smaller market. But if you get smaller than that, if you start moving to the smaller bedroom communities, the DFW area, the Houston and Austin area, then you really start to find that there's not a lot of comps that you can look at. It's hard to figure out, you know, where the folks are going to come from. And, you know, looking at some of these smaller markets does become a challenge during the underwriting process.
Wichita Falls.
But it's you go to some place like Childers or Plainview or, you know, smaller like that, then it's really a challenge to try to underwrite, try to figure out where the tenants currently live,
sure,
and at what price point are they going to break free income to your product, and maybe just because it's new, they will.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's a whole different list of sensitivities too when you're talking small markets. So I'll even go as so far as to say, you know, markets, you know, population base is less than 20,000, you know. So we've lended and invested in those in communities.
Land passes.
We know each other very well.
Great community. It's a great community. I'll retire there one day. But you're talking a different set of, because just as, you know, David mentioned, you're trying to find out, you know, where the tenants live at this point, and you really have to kind of expand your knowledge. You're not only talking about rental comps, but, you know, you start looking at, you know, rental homes, you know, mobile home parks. You're really starting to push your, you know, underwriting out, and the sensitivities too. And it's not only the sensitivity during the lease up, but it's also the, you know, the 15-year operating. You know, I'm sure Brian, you know, loves to, you know, put a, you know, look at deals and these types of markets where you can have very flat rent growth, and you can have, you know, expenses may, you know, have that flat growth too. But if you're not in a market that has that growth potential, and you hit year 7 and 8, and you have no other options to go out, and all of a sudden you find yourself overlevered, you know, with, you know, 5-10 years left, you know, within your loan cycle,
sure.
It's, you're going to have a struggling asset for a long time.
Yeah, I would say that just a short answer to your question is the LTV and debt coverage and vacancy factors and things like that. We do tend to be a little bit more conservative.
It's more pronounced, huh?
Yeah. On the smaller markets.
Yeah, I think you have to be careful also about you know, what the employment base is in these smaller markets. We did a deal in Louisiana that had a big chicken factory that produced all the jobs, and then they decided to close it. And so the jobs just weren't there.
Does Chagrin go to Louisiana? No, somebody else.
So you have to watch that. I think, you know, as a equity investor where you're looking at a 15-year investment, as a permanent lender, that these things become more and more important because you are a longer-term investor. You know, thank God for the 538 program the USDA puts out there for some of these 25,000, I think it is 25,000 smaller population communities, because that's a great exit strategy for some of these smaller deals where you don't necessarily want to take the permanent loan risk on a community. Some of these smaller communities, you also have to look at expanding the PMA and deciding, you know, maybe there's in-migration from other areas. It may be a very small area, but there's places around it that people may be driving from.
The good news is all the market study guys have expanded the PMA for us.
Yeah, that's true. So you may have to do it further.
Yes. USDA program, by the way, is great, but I've stopped calling the 538. It's the 53011, because they come in at the 11th hour. Like, you've already underwritten the deal, you're waiting to close, and you're just waiting.
No, I call it the 530 wait.
Wait.
So always play on words.
So let's circle back up on this in terms of smaller markets. One of the outgrowth issues that we've seen on the 9% round of the QAP in recent years is you go to a market, right? I don't want to pick per se any geography, but the QAP is like a divining rod right now, right? Like, you go to a town, and there might be 3 inches in that market that you can develop that you get enough points, right? And turns out they have enough room allocation for 3 deals. And all 3 deals, you look for the 1 mile and 1 inch rule, because they're all like next to each other. And they're all within the same smaller community. And they all get awarded. And then they all get done by different lenders who figure out later that all 3 were there. How do you look at that? I'm assuming that's an additional factor you're trying to figure out, is not only this particular deal that you might be looking at, but what about the other 2 in that market? How does that play in? Just curious.
So I guess a couple of years ago, I guess the, you know, Alton was the poster child for that, where there's 3 deals. Fortunately, Alton was one of those deals down the valley where it's a very, very small town, but just, you know, Hidalgo County, it's got 800,000 plus people, and it's growing like crazy. So that was actually kind of easy to underwrite.
Sure.
We did one of those, and I guess the other 2 did get done in various phases. So, you know, your goal is to be the first one, first one developed if possible, and not the last one.
Although I will say, the way the equity round has gone, the first guy who develops gets 1 price. By the time the third guy comes around to develop, that price has gone up 5 cents. So it makes it a lot easier to underwrite the third deal then at that point.
But that's one of those markets, you know, we're talking about small markets and you know, the valley's full of, you know, little tiny towns, but a huge population, and they're willing to drive, you know, to the nicer stuff.
Yeah, there seems like there's like 5 deals in Iowa Park, wherever the heck that is, every year. And I don't, you know, somehow the dividing rod goes to like Iowa Park. And I don't know how it gets there or how that gets done. Yeah. But there just seems to be multiple deals in that small market. I'm curious about that. And that probably goes to Ray's comment, like when you get to 20,000, you know, but when you get to suburban Corpus Christi or Brownsville or something, it's a lot easier, I guess. But
well, I want to say, and you know, sometimes the overlap is not just restricted to small towns like Alton. I mean, we saw back in, you know, 2012 and 2013 when, you know, the QAP kind of opened it up for, you know, when the high opportunity, you know, concept really started rolling, you know, we just saw the influx of senior deals. You know, I don't think there was maybe, you know, within a 3-year period, they almost every deal, you know, in Houston was a senior deal. And we've, you know, we all, you know, participated in those. When we saw very extended lease-up periods because, you know, they're all, you know, fighting for the same, you know, grandma during that period. It was, you know, when you have competing deals in overlapping markets that have that kind of specialized, you know, niche, that made it tough too. So it's not just reserved for, you know, small markets. I mean, major metros, if you have a concentration of, you know, affordable products in one area, that, you know, that can cause the same issues.
Sure. Now, I guess because we've got a variety of debt product out here, I guess maybe one way to sort that out, you know, divvy that up a little bit is there might be one you look at as a balance sheet execution, one might be an FHA execution, and one might be, you know, to help address some of the risk here or there, right, ultimately.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think about maybe a good way to kind of give a few examples of what might be a good balance sheet deal and FHA deal. We just acquired FHA lender a couple of years ago. And my first D4 originated and closed down in the Valley. I tell you what, we couldn't have done this. This was not a portfolio product at all because some of the challenges we talked about being in the small market, you know, and it needed proceeds. You know, they were maxed out on what they could get for pricing in a market like that, and they needed the proceeds to kind of get over the hump. And FHA was the only one that really kind of fit the bucket of getting the amount of proceeds to make the deal work and viable. And then you have, you know, FHA willing to take that, you know, long-term risk in a market like that as, you know, as the investor. And we had comfort having a, you know, HUD-insured debt, you know, being behind HUD-insured debt versus, you know, maybe a conventional type of product. So I think it's real important to marrying your type of deal to which type of debt product is, I think, is really important on the front end.
You know, circling back on that, you know, as you get to those smaller market transactions where they're really small, going back to the first question related to mixed income, while those smaller market transactions aren't 50% market, I don't know if you guys have run into this, but many of them are 10% market. And that 10% market might actually account for 30% of the income, right? And I've come across, I haven't done it, so don't anybody hold me to that. But I've got some syndicator partners who are very disciplined, who underwrite operating deficit guarantees on those market rate units for the full compliance period, that they have a threshold test to underwrite that structure. And on a couple of deals, that's, you know, initially, developer wasn't as thrilled about it, but ultimately it was something you live with because they were going to hold that deal long term anyway, and they believed in it and they could work through it. So I've seen some adjustment structures over the last, I don't know, 3-4 years related to those market rate units specifically in a small market deal because they wind up being, you know, 10% of the mix these days. Just thought I'd throw that out there. So 8 years post downturn. A lot of deals that were done pre-downturn are now exiting their 15-year compliance. Things called re-syndication exit strategies. What are you guys seeing out there? For as it relates to, say, debt, in terms of debt opportunity, are you seeing restructures? Are you seeing bridge loans? Are you seeing re-syndications? What are you coming across?
Yeah, well, I think we're seeing combination of all of that, where there are properties that are coming off compliance, people are going through the ROFR process and trying to get these under contract. They may need a bridge loan for 2, 3, 4 years to give them time to reposition, get the property ready to go back through the program, whether it's a 9 or 4%, or if they just eventually want to execute into something long-term on an immediate funding basis. So I think we're seeing, and we'll see more of that. And that's, you know, we're probably 2001, 2002 type properties. And so we're going to, it's going to continue to be an uptick in that market where we have that opportunity.
Sure.
We struggled a little bit on the concept, you know, probably about 3 or 4 years ago, at least on a balance sheet, you know, because we, at Capital One, we approached it as, you know, if you want to acquire GP interest, you know, this is going to be kind of a straight up acquisition product. We're going to, you know, require, you know, very low or pretty substantial equity investment. And so for a while, we never really had that niche. But however, again, now with the agency, we figured out how aggressive, you know, Freddie in particular has been providing products for, you know, acquisition purposes. So I think one of the products they have is a bridge to resyndication right now. So they'll give you basically a 2-year interest-only loan as long as you have kind of that, if you're an experienced developer and have done this before and you have your path to getting your 4% in a couple of years, they'll give you a 2-year, you know, interest-only bridge loan for that, for a, you know, limited equity injection. In addition to, they just have, you know, straight up acquisition products like a, you know, 80%, you know, 7-year loan, the 1-year lockout, very aggressive terms that I think, you know, the agency lenders and the GSEs are starting to buy on. But there's a lot of opportunity out there for that.
No, you make a good point. I mean, at Citi, I could tell you we do an awful lot of bridge lending, acquisition. We don't like to use the word bridge. Strike that out. We call it acquisition financing. We're not big on pre-development for new construction or anything, but for acquisition financing, we do an awful lot. So we were very mindful when Freddie came out with their product as well. And going to your point, Ray, I think we're seeing more and more developers who are in the at rehab type business or with their existing stuff as they're taking on that might have 5 years left on compliance, trying to use the Freddie variable rate product, right, to get a bridge. You know, so you got two components. You've got the ones that are already expiring off of 15 years, and you have the ones that are got 3 or 4 years left. So you can't really do anything. You gotta kind of store them away for a little bit, right? And so we're seeing a lot of bridge product from that standpoint.
We're seeing some funds too that are coming together to try to do this on a larger scale. A lot of private equity funds are getting involved. Sometimes, you know, they call themselves impact funds or preservation funds, and sometimes you have to really look in the fine print, because some of these, even though they call themselves a preservation fund, they're not, you know, they're not really going to maintain the affordability over time. And we've also, we're investing with, there's a couple banks out there that are doing these funds themselves, and we've gotten comfortable with some of those funds because the banks do have the long-term goal of keeping the affordability. And so we've invested in some of those as well. And it's a nice way to kind of diversify your product, get a little better equity type return, and also build your pipeline for future rate resyndication 2 or 3 years or whenever they get a 4% credit or 9% credit and just, you know, do the full rehab. So we've looked at several of those.
So are any of you guys seeing portfolio acquisition requests where, so maybe they're in the latter stages. Someone's wanting to exit out. There have been a few of those in Texas, right? Mm-hmm. But they're not quite out of the compliance period. Right? You got maybe 2, 3, maybe it's a portfolio of, say, 10. And within the 10, you know, a couple have maybe 6 months left, a couple have 3 years left, you know, all varying degrees. And you can't get a lien on the property because somebody else has got the debt, right? Mm-hmm. They're waiting for that maturity. But, you know, maybe they're wanting you to finance the partnership interests to make the sale go through. Have you guys seen opportunities along those lines?
I have seen some of those, and we've treated them as an equity investment as opposed to to debt. And again, the yields tend to be more attractive, the IRRs, you know, as opposed to getting a 3.5% IRR on, you know, today's 9% LIHTC deals in a major market. You know, you can get perhaps double digit, at least on paper, it's double digit.
Not having collateral helps that yield, huh?
That's right.
That's good. That's good. So on the resyndication side, though, I know we're seeing an awful lot of product re-syndicated, obviously not for 9% rounds because it doesn't lend itself well in this state going through the QAP process, but on the tax-exempt side, the 4% side, we're seeing an awful lot of re-syndications, and we've got a few clients whose sole or predominant business model is re-syndication. Are you coming across that as well? And what's the appetite level?
Not as much on our end. Again, so, you know, we're primarily focused still on new construction within this market. I think, though, the opportunities for 4%, I think we're starting to see those. The big issues that we're seeing right now, even though, you know, tax credit pricing is at an all-time high.
All-time high. Big cap letter for the camera. All-time high.
Won't go any higher at all. But with the benefits of great tax credit pricing and, you know, the low interest rate environment and the great products, my goodness, sometimes you're still seeing, you know, sizable gaps, mostly because construction prices are high. Because, you know, Texas and a lot of markets, we're going to re-up another 15 years. We're going to want to see substantial, you know, work done. You know, if you're planning to, you know, spend $15,000-$20,000 on a unit, that's just probably a bit light, you know, for our taste. We're going to, if we're going to be the investor, if we're going to be the lender, we're probably going to want to see some decent overhaul within a unit, depending what your scope's going to be. But a lot of times, those costs just don't pencil out.
I will tell you, I'm a loan-to-cost person, and when it has come to rehabs, I've always wanted to see a gut rehab. I've probably adjusted my thought process a bit in the last 2 years, where I've seen product coming off of the compliance period that really did only need about $15,000 to $20,000 a unit, because the original developer, it happened to be, now that's probably an unusual circumstance, but I am seeing it more, so I won't say it's rare, right? Where the product's actually in pretty darn good shape. It was actually an A product when it was built, and it might have been built in Dallas or Austin, maybe the developers in Houston, and it's got the right of first refusal, and that's not a core holding asset, and they want to sell it off. And so I've seen more of that, where I think that is where I think the state's bond product has good use, right? For when you're that minimum threshold where I can say, hey, you know, that is actually probably a little bit more viable to do that. But I think generally agreement, like to see a gut rehab when it's being done, even on re-syndication, given the product quality in general.
Yeah, I mean, I will say there's a difference between the standards, construction standards now versus, you know, 15, 20 years ago. I think that there's just a major difference. So I've seen, you know, more kind of a market standard, you know, with recent deals.
And even with the construction standards changing, the level of amenities in units and in the product that was built 10 years ago, 15 years ago, you rehab it and you put $15,000 or $20,000 in it, but are you going to be able to compete with the new 9% deal that's got all the different bells and whistles
sure.
that included? So you got to keep that in mind and look at the submarkets. And
yeah, a lot of times you have a locational advantage. That's one of the things I like about the rehab is they might have been more in the core, you know, as
right.
opposed to
out
on the outskirts.
Yep.
So.
But I think realistically, too, though, they're probably at this point in the cycle where the affordable cycle is because of the pent-up demand in the major metros, because we haven't had a significant plethora of bond product where we don't have 250, you know, you go through the last cycle, right? Again, we're talking about 8 years post-downturn. You go 06, 07 at the peak. What do we have, 50, 60 bond deals going on here a year? 250 units a pop, some 280,
yeah.
260, right? And you might have had 2,500, 3,000 units in Houston coming on the affordable side.
Mm-hmm.
Same thing in Dallas, Fort Worth, Austin. And now, earlier comment, you're under 1,000, right? You take out the senior product, and the family product is negligible.
Underserved.
Yeah.
Makes a lot of re-syndicated deals look more viable simply because you have an existing tenant base and they could probably re-tenant as they went through.
Sure.
Right? Just because, I mean, so I think that might add a little bit to where we are in the cycle, as opposed to, say, if we were in 09 or 10, I think many of us would not have looked at that as favorably then, right? We for sure wouldn't have taken 15 or 20 grand,
no.
Right?
Right.
A unit. So that probably has a bit to do it as well. Permanent loan options, right? That has evolved. And just as a probably a little bit of a primer for folks who are maybe a little bit familiar or not as familiar with the history here in Texas, I know when I first got into this business almost 20 years ago, Fannie Mae was the 8,000-pound gorilla in Texas, right? We did these Fannie Mae cash forwards. I still have nightmares on occasion. You know, you wake up in the middle of the night screaming, I won't give you an LC, I don't want, you know. And so you had to take down the permanent loan day one, right? Fannie wanted a letter of credit. They didn't want to take any construction risk. And you provided a bridge above that, right? Get that paid off at perm, convert over, made no money. And you went about your merry way, right? Freddie Mac had their own cash forward, same thing. Then we evolved, at least down here, right? So those were the two predominant ways. Balance and sheet were not in the same sentence at that time, right? And then somewhere, I think it might have been late 01, 02, Freddie did something that was just earth-shattering. They did an unfunded forward, which in this market, you know, for those of you who do bond deals here and you know that bond deals are fully funded at close, that was the way our 9% process was, right? With the way perms were. The unfunded forward was a dramatic change in the state. And it can't overemphasize that enough. This is a state devoid generally of soft money compared to a lot of other states, right? We don't have in the capital stack. Good thing about Texas, we are a clean state that way, right? Debt, equity, and there's nothing else. So the unfunded forward was a big deal, right? You know, it's like Christmas every day for a little bit. Then as 06 rolled around, 07, the amount of product coming online, beginnings of the downturn, Freddie and Fannie basically stopped production, right? I remember during that time, as rates were adjusting, you know, the spreads were at really high levels. I mean, I think I remember the last Freddie deal during the initial downturn phase that I did was 8.89% was the fixed rate. It didn't matter if the Treasury was minus 5 basis points, the rate was going to be there. So they basically exited out of the market. And then balance and sheet began to be in the same sentence, in the same thought, right? And started evolving from an agency marketplace, Fannie, Freddie, with some FHA. Texas has historically, back at that period of time, pre-downturn, we weren't a big HUD state. Right? We weren't a big FHA state on new construction 9% deals. We did some bond deals, did a lot of bond deals, FHA, because at that time, the FHA product, Ginnie Mae tax exempt, was pretty attractive, but did not do that on the 9% side. Fast forward, get through the downturn, balance and sheet come together, a lot of balance sheet product, start seeing a few 9% deals on FHA. Right? I did tons of balance sheet. I was Mr. Balance Sheet. Right, Ray?
Yeah, same here. No, balance sheet became kind of the core product for us. So construction to perm type of process where, you know, we were able to go out there and sell a one-stop shop. You know, we'll, you know, let you float or we'll give you a fixed rate during construction and give you a forward lock, you know, towards the end. And so I feel like that's kind of been everybody's, you know, kind of forte over the last, you know, 7-8 years. But now, again, we're starting to see now the GSEs come roaring back again, because as we talked about before, Freddie has become very aggressive within the affordable space. And a year or two ago, they started introducing they started repricing their forward product. Because, you know, at the end of the day, you know, our balance sheet pricing would beat them primarily, no problem. Nowadays, it's it's almost as, the same, basically.
Yeah.
And so now what we're also able to do, though, we talked a little bit earlier about marrying, you know, the specific debt with the type of deal that you have. Well, now that you have, look, here's a very clean deal in a high metro area, very shiny and new, and it has a lot of high impact. That might sound great for a portfolio lender, one who's willing to take that on their balance sheet. You might have one with a little bit of hair on it where the market's changing a little bit. That might be an agency type of deal or whatever have you. But I'm just finding now that there's much more options than I've seen even 5 years ago. I don't know if you guys have seen the same.
Yeah, and we've got some, you know, we're doing some balance sheet loans as well on the perm side and building in some flexibility in terms of whether you decide you ultimately want to close into it or not. We are locking the rate, holding it for 24 or 30 months, and then giving the borrower the option to convert into, you know, our permanent loan or go find an immediate delivery, which could be at a more favorable rate. But once you close into the perm loan, then we are on standard, you know, Fannie type docs where you've got a full yield maintenance. But, you know, having a balance sheet program allows you a little bit of flexibility in those regards.
Yes, I've been a little bit different over the last few years.
Sure.
We haven't done any balance sheet lending. We do have some relationships with some proprietary lenders that we underwrite for and close for and sell to as soon as it closes, as soon as it converts from construction. So it's kind of the same effect as far as the borrower is concerned.
Well, and
so
also, I mean, it does help, especially with you and Wells being large equity investors,
yeah.
That has allowed transactions to flow through a bit differently as well. Dave, any thoughts?
I think it's a combination of balance sheet that we're seeing and working with third-party lenders, probably
yep.
the impact capital insurance companies that are looking for solid 30-year return on their money.
Yep.
So,
it's rare to see an LC deal anymore, right? Does anybody do an LC deal at all?
Yeah.
You know, I think there's only a few banks that have probably the credit rating that can do that, but. You know, why do you want to do that? You lose control. I mean, the letter of credit can get called on you and you don't have a chance to work anything out.
And you don't make any money on it.
And you don't make any money. That's true.
Money.
And it's just an expensive execution for the borrower, too, so I don't know why you do it.
Do banks want to make money?
No.
Is that what you're saying?
You got to make something.
Yeah, okay. Yeah.
All right. That's just Mungo. Yes. We got to make something.
Yeah.
Oh, then.
Banks want
yes,
to make money, right?
But I guess another product evolution on that perm side, right? When last cycle, again going back to downturn, I remember I got to give Brian Gallagher credit for this and a lot of grief from CDT. He's a good friend of mine. I love you, Brian. I remember I think it was 07. Brian said, you know, we've got a 35-year AM product. I think the market's heading to 40. It was. Having seizures in the back, listening to that. About the time the spigot, I think, was going off, going to 35, 40. And then we went back down to 30. Mm-hmm. Pretty darn quick, right? A good downturn really can do that. You get down to 30. And now I think we're back to 35. We do 35, mm-hmm. right? We do full balance sheet execution on 35. Freddie's doing 35. Fannie's new product. Their ROAR product, 35.
Portfolios, I would have to say most portfolio lenders probably still try to stick to 30-year, you know, just because, you know, that's what we do. We'll try to maybe, you know, provide some advantageous pricing to, you know, maybe compete. But again, on the GSE side, you know, Freddie, Fannie, no, 35-year options, you know, are definitely out there. I would say, though, you know, going forward, you know, within this market, you know, as competitive, you know, pressures might, you know, push people out there. We are looking at things on an exception basis, going 35 where we need to in good markets. So,
yeah, I think the 35-year has become sort of the norm in the major markets. You know, back to our secondary, tertiary market discussion, that might be more where you're going to find the 30-year. Not too many lenders are going to do 35 in some of these smaller rural settings.
So if you're underwriting construction. Everybody's like, I got a perm takeout, but you still got to be happy with it. So when you're taking a look at that in a smaller market deal, you got a perm takeout that's pretty aggressive, 35, 90% LTV, 115, How do you look at it? I don't have to answer that question.
We might, one alternative would be we might size the loan based on a, let's say, 30-year, 120 debt coverage. I'm sorry. We might size the loan such that the loan amount is based on a 30-year amortization at a 120 debt coverage, and maybe hold back the difference that is fundable if that, you know, but don't fund it until conversion. Does that make sense? I'm kind of explaining there.
So you just pass it on the small market deal? Just kidding.
Well, no, Brian brings up a good point.
You make a great point, Brian.
No, as far as holdback, look, I mean, a lot of things could be solved with money, too. You know, that's one thing we like. So if there's enough fee in the deal, if there's enough, you know, if you have a good guarantor support, you know.
I'm sorry, I did say smaller market deals. Okay,
You did. I didn't stutter. It's okay. No, there's a lot of things that could be solved. Again, you know, money. Money's always a great way of solving problems, having a, you know, solid guarantor behind you. You know, all those things go into consideration as well, even on small market deals.
Plus, you might have done 10 other deals with that sponsor in the past. And,
absolutely.
Although that might be a reason not to do the next one, but that's a discussion. Ken, you got any thoughts on that?
It really just depends upon, you know, who the perm lender is on that. If it's as we talked about 538 earlier, I mean, that's their specialty, so I wouldn't worry about it. You know, them ultimately converting.
No, there's not a sizing issue with them either.
Yeah, that's right. That's a good point, too. Yeah, that's right. They do just fund. Yep. They re-underwrite you.
So what are you seeing, I guess, in, as it relates to perm, in terms of for those that are doing, say, balance sheet, right? Because it's easy enough, which is great, right? The market's really opened up. Agency debt is back. There's a separate panel later on bonds, but we're the full debt panel, right? So I'll mention that. On the bond side, Freddie's got their TEL product. A lot of us do balance sheet also. Fannie Mae's got a certain product that's competitive for ACT Rehab, right? On the balance sheet side, though, because remember, this is, I guess, a structural question, balance sheet question, rather, depth. A lot of us have been doing balance sheet, right, Ray, for 7-8 years.
Yeah, absolutely. And when it comes to bonds, you know, private placement has been, you know, I don't know if there's been a lot of transactions in Texas that haven't gone private placement, to be honest with you. Just, I mean, the savings and the underwriting costs.
Well, here's my question to you, though. So you got 7-8 years of where you haven't had the luxury, and that's part of it too, right? It's not like a lot of us woke up to do balance sheet lending because, although I love balance sheet lending, a lot of us, you're smiling, Gilbert, a lot of us have been doing it because the alternate product was not there, right? Here's my question, get to it. How much are you willing to hold, right? You don't necessarily need to answer, but it's a thoughtful, you know, how much are you willing to hold on a balance sheet, right? When you go back and you look at your book, and you start, say, in 08, right? You know, David goes to Bruce Martin back there and says, hey, Bruce, we're going to start doing balance sheet lending. Bruce says, I'm going on vacation for 6 months. I'll catch you. We'll talk when I get back.
I came back.
He came back. But, right, you start balance sheet lending, say, really rising at that point, right? The barrel. So you do construction lease up. You go through a couple years. 2010, 2011, they start converting over, right? So you've got like 5 years now where stuff's on the books and it's incrementally getting. So yeah, you're getting payments, but the book is growing. Mm-hmm. So now the deals are getting larger because going back to the first question on mixed income, Stuart Shaw's in Maine. Hey, Stuart. The perms are large, right? It's like 17 million, 15 million. Yeah. This is 9% deal. Right? Then you start doing, I closed a balance sheet, construction perm last week. I do balance sheet. $25 million on the perm.
Jeez, wow.
Right?
I'm glad that was you.
So I guess that's my question for those who are looking at balance sheet or the institutional side of it. Ken, your platform is newer.
Right.
But that's probably a more critical ingredient on the thought process on the front end, how much you're wanting to hold over time and so forth. How do you look at that? Like, at some point, do you go, hey, we're kind of full up. We'd like to do more agency perm product.
Yeah.
We'll like to do balance sheet because we're more comfortable with it now, 7-8 years in. What's the thought process there?
I really defer to my credit officer on that one. No, you know, we do think about that, and we're, you know, it's on down the line for us, but we think about what our exit is, you know, from a number of standpoints, recycling capital, and not getting too much exposure to any one developer on our books, because as you, you know, have your permanent loan sitting there for 15, 18 years, and you continue doing, you know, construction and equity with the same developers, you start building up an exposure issue.
Yeah.
And so it is, you know, we've thought about exit strategies. We've talked to your friend Brian Gallagher about possibly, you know, buying some of the portfolio when
sure.
it seasons after several years, you know, wait till you get whatever the critical mass is and decide to. And the other thing it does is it just proves to your credit guys, because we all ultimately have to, you know, face our credit folks, that there is liquidity in the market and you know, these loans are ultimately saleable.
And rates do keep dropping so they can get refinanced out.
Yeah, yeah, and rates go up, it's a problem.
They do, but I gotta say, you know, at Capital One, you know, so we've had about 7-8 years of portfolio, you know, of growing, and, you know, I wanna say we have maybe over $500 million in perm debt, you know, on the books at this point. And I gotta say, you know, every year I'm always waiting for that call, like, you know, we're gonna dump. Our finance team loves this stuff. They love having the cash flows, you know, from these deals. And, you know, and from an underwriting standpoint, these, you know, these are very solid, safe deals with us, the investor. And, you know, we're doing, you know, very deals with a kind of a built-in market advantage, you know. You know, our typical commercial CRE would never take on this type of, you know, product. But here, as an affordable product, there's a lot of appetite for it. And, you know, to Ken's point, it's marketable. We've had
yep.
we've turned down offers before to sell our book of business just because we like it so much. So
I know at Citi, like, we do a lot of balance sheet execution. Probably 70% of our stuff is balance sheet, but we do a huge amount of Freddie and Fannie, right? A lot of affordable. But we underwrite even the balance sheet deals. We want to make sure that one of the agencies will ultimately buy it. Whether or not we sell it's a different matter, right? Mm-hmm. We've got deals that are on the books that have been there 15 years, 20 years, we've never sold. We haven't sold a lot of stuff in a long, long time. But we go, the entry point as opposed to the exit, right? You go in with the idea of, will somebody be willing to take it? And we all have exceptions, right, that we put on, but that is an ongoing thought process. You know, I've actually at Citi, go to make calls to Fannie or Freddie and say, hey, this is the kind of deal you wouldn't do maybe now, I'm pretty sure of it, but would you take it as part of a pool later on, right? Scatter type deals.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Okay. Non-light tech. That's a debt pound, right? Everything we did was 100% tax credit. You know, all things all the time have that. I remember when I got started, there was some decent level of non-tax credit, and probably more in our community development oriented space, right? So when you're a pure debt shop, equity shop looking for volume, and you're doing agency work, you tend to see a little bit less of that. But a lot of you guys up here, I think all of you, do a, you know, CRA oriented lending. Mm-hmm. Tax credit space is obviously the 1,000-pound gorilla in that space. But what are you seeing on the non-light tech type of lending? Are you doing it? What types of deals do you see out there? What's going on in that space?
I mean, we've, go ahead.
I was just going to say, I think that there are products that are out there. If you were, this morning, Valerie headed up a panel on market rate housing where they had a couple of market rate developers talking about some of the differences in what investors look for, not from a LIHTC versus a market rate type product. And there's some similarities, but I think there are enough differences that, you know, for a CRA lender, doing non-LIHTC type lending would probably roll over to the commercial real estate group for them to take a look at, and not be necessarily in the community development department. At least that's how I see it.
We've looked at, you know, some possibilities. So we, you know, Ken, you mentioned before workforce housing, and it's always kind of been something, you know, at least Capital One has looked at. You know, this is, it's, I feel like it's been an underserved need. We've seen tens of thousands of units hit the markets within these major metros, primarily all A-class. You know, we're talking, you know, $1.50 plus rent, stuck, you know, $1.30. We've seen very little to none B-class developments. You know, good, you know, fine areas don't have to have all the, you know, A-class amenities, don't have to be located in Midtown in Houston or downtown in Austin or anywhere else. But in good, decent suburban markets, we just, you have not seen that type of product. So we've had, we haven't closed any, but we've had some very advanced discussions with, you know, lots of developers, you know, providing the financing for this type of product. And it's going to be much more akin to what you would see on the market rate side. So you see maybe a five-year mini perm versus a 15-year debt options. However, you know, Fannie and Freddie have been very open-minded to what they would consider as affordable as well. The big X factor, obviously, if it's non-LIHTC, where are you getting the equity from? You know, most investors, I think, out in the market are still looking for double-digit prefs, you know, at this point. So who's going to come in and fill that gap, you know, on the equity side? That's where the gap has been. You know, there's been some, you know, talks where maybe we put together, like NEF you talked about, has a fund, you know, to come into to do some of these workforce housing models. But unless you have, you know, maybe some subsidy, maybe an abatement or something else, it's kind of like a bond deal. You know, they're really hard to structure if you don't have the right capital stack.
And you generally don't have a predetermined takeout, you know, a locked rate. So you have to be willing to treat it, you know, like the market rate guys do, just on a term basis, and just know that you're going to have it on your books for 3 or 4 years or whatever, and then they'll have to go out and find a permanent loan home at that time. So you take the market rate risk on that.
So Brian Jarvis, this is a slam dunk roll up layup for you. Bank of America, just for everyone's benefit. As I think there are limited banks that do this, but you are the most well-known for having your own CDC and being a part of the development and doing financing, which I assume in a lot of cases is non-LIHTC.
Yeah, you put me on the spot. I have not been involved with a lot of the deals that they've done in that capacity. I do get involved with them quite a bit when they partner with developers, and those are almost always LIHTC deals.
They're all okay, they're all always LIHTC deals.
So,
no worries. I'm just curious about that. Valerie, are you at all familiar with on the non-LIHTC space there?
So workforce housing, we've done at least one deal. We're looking at another one right now. So and they basically have brought in, for lack of a better description, a mezzanine
debt.
Right. Yeah. To be the equity. And it is subject to the HBCRE requirement where they have to have 15% of the money in cash for equity, and they cannot recoup that equity until such time as it converts to a permanent home.
So for everyone's benefit, you know, we hear about Dodd-Frank and regulatory oversight, right, on banks. One of the outgrowths of that is a process that's come through in the last several years where you can't just, from a leverage standpoint, loan-to-cost standpoint, there are certain parameters on real estate that classify it as, here's a real estate deal you can do, and where it falls outside of those parameters and has to be counted differently. And trying to get someone internally at a bank these days to want to count it differently, right? I got a better shot of doing a 100-year amortization loan. So that is an ongoing struggle, and that's a good point, Valerie. That probably curtails certain types of lending and investment. Inherently, they were curtailed just in terms of market demand and, you know, where capital is going to come from. But at this point in the cycle where there's plenty of capital, looking for all sorts of opportunities, and this is the one part of the cycle, you know, again, recurring theme, right, we're 8 years post-downturn, where you would find those type of opportunities, the regulatory side is also impactful there in curtailing the amount you can do. That's a great point. All right, before I get to another question, just so that we don't run out of time, do we have any questions from the audience? Put you guys on the spot. Maybe some. Gilbert, can you come to the mic, please? We are full recording.
Full recording.
So if you can speak clearly in and ask your questions.
To my fellow bankers on the panel, as we're beginning to see more and more preservation projects, that have HAP contracts. How do you guys get comfortable when those HAP contract rents are substantially higher than your LIHTC rents?
We refer them to Gilbert. No, I'm just kidding.
We're going to let the underwriter handle the overhang question. So
the overhang, the underhang. Come on. Come on. That's a great question. We see a lot of this, right? We got, you know, fair amount of this.
Normally, I mean, the conservative approach is to underwrite them at the maximum allowable rents and to treat the overhang as an additional
strip.
Yeah.
So right before the downturn, we'll go back to this and hopefully stay on message here. I would see A and B notes. We're not doing A and B notes. Don't freak out. But you would see, right? You'd see normal underwriting on what the deal could support at LIHTC rents, right? And you'd have the overhang piece that gets amortized over the life of the contract accelerated. That's the B piece, right? Explaining that to a client who then said, I thought you really liked me. Especially when it was 07, that was a little harder discussion. But it became an easier discussion because in 08, we just didn't do it. Didn't finance it, and we really showed them the love. What are you guys seeing? You guys seeing B pieces? I mean, I know generally it was a lot easier, and I could probably say this for all of us. In 9, 10, 11, 12, the worst things got, but the rents were more rational relative to where things were down here. You didn't mind the overhang as much. Because when you're on an upward trajectory on rents, because it's like, how bad could this get? We're, you know, down here, things kind of work in your favor. But at this point in the cycle, a little higher, mm-hmm. for certain. How do you look at it? How do you look at that?
You know, I think ultimately you sort of operate on faith that it's really not going to happen. I mean, credit guy always wants to look at the worst possible scenario. But in reality, are we really not going to get HUD rents funded? And if so, then you know, you've got to think that there's going to be some adjustment so that you're no longer stuck with just LIHTC rents. There has to be some way to increase the revenues, or you're going to have a whole bunch of projects going back, and you'll lose affordability and all kinds of stuff as these get foreclosed on. So you got to think there will be a global fix if, you know, the unlikely situation that the HAP contracts weren't funded were to occur. That said, you know, we do look at the overhang. We do look at the operating reserves and see, you know, how long can you feed the project with certain assumptions with the existing operating reserve. Maybe you want the operating reserve to be a little higher and the guarantee to stay on a little longer in some of those situations. So there are workarounds, but ultimately I say you just hope it doesn't happen, because it would be a disaster for our industry.
On ACT Rehab product, I know one of the things we do, because, you know, we had someone who wants to do a rehab and get a new 15-year contract, right? Section 8, 15-year contract. What we've done also is, because we got to look at the exit test, right, kind of thing. And so it's like it's the entry point's good, but on the back end, how's it going to look for the next lender to refinance out if the overhang is huge? Mm-hmm. So in cases where we know the overhang is really large, right, one of the things we kind of want to do is, how did the last contract adjust, right? They've already been under a contract. What was the adjustment rent increase on average? So we had a deal recently. I think the rent average was 2.3%. You know how everybody trends rents and expenses? Rents go up 2 and expenses go up 3, and it never plays out that way, right? This one trended 2.3. So there was documented history. Now, I don't know how well that's going to track in the future. Was documented history that for, I don't know, 10, 15 years, they generally got on average 2.3, like clockwork. And it wasn't like 5%, 1%. It was 2.2, 2.4, all the way through. So that was a decent basis to take a look on the overhang, trend it. So anyway, just a thought. Yeah. Right?
And I would just, you know, hit Ken's point too, that, you know, we've evolved ourselves how we look at overhang and how we've underwritten it. And look, we have credit officers too that have heartburn on some of the deals that we present. And there's usually, especially when we're the equity, we're able to negotiate something with like a ODG or springing guarantee or something to get us comfortable if the case arises. But one of the things that has helped us evolve the way we look at, you know, the, over the years, looking at past history, we'll look at, you know, the last budget crisis about 2 or 3 years ago when HUD gets a $600 million whack out of its, you know, operating budget. You know, what did they do? Did they cut back rents? Did they end contracts? No, but they did. Yes, it obviously affected on, you know, new contracts going forward, but they preserved, you know, the housing or the contracts that they had in place.
Yep.
You know, and they had to move some money around to make sure that that was the case. But just to show you what the political will is to make sure that, you know, they are, you know, the serving the most needed, you know, portion of the country with housing. And I think housing more and more has become, you know, put on the forefront. And I think there's very little political will to, you know, to end that. I'm not going to say, look, we shouldn't be looking at it. There shouldn't be a quantifiable risk that's out there. But it's definitely something you want to talk to your lender and investor of how they approach it.
So are you guys seeing the opposite, though, going to Gilbert's question, though? Are you guys seeing the opposite? I know I see this. The underhang is what I call it, right? Where everyone's been focused on the overhang where LIHTC rent might be 600, but the contract comes out at 800 or $1,000. Have you guys seen contracts? I see these now quite regularly on re-syndicated deals and other deals where the LIHTC rent is 600, the contract's 500. And that was what was agreed to back then. And it's got, I don't know, another 5-7 years at specified determined levels. I see that on RAD for sure, mm-hmm. Right?
Yeah.
You know, you get a RAD deal, rental assistance demonstration contract for the camera, as public housing converts, you know, over to rental assistance demonstration, the equivalent of a HAP contract, but for public housing, a lot of those deals, they're not getting LIHTC rents, right? They're getting
bare bones,
Bare loans, right? Yeah. So it's actually more of a, you can't loan the project as much money simply because the rents are now capped down here, causes a different issue. Have you guys seen that?
Not so much, you know, most of the RAD deals that, you know, again, RAD's probably the only case I've ever seen that, but usually with RAD has, I've seen come other subsidies to help cap staff or whatever else.
Yeah, housing authority puts in several million or whatever.
Right, whatever they have to, yeah.
I will for the audience tell you though, if you're a developer and you're acquiring or have an existing Section 8 contract in a large portfolio, but especially you're acquiring a property that's got an existing HAP contract on it, and you're trying to put it in to the 9% round, go back and double check that contract. Some of those contracts have limitations on what the rents are, and you're actually capped here. So you're underwriting LIHTC rents, and as you dig deeper during your application phase, you find that the rent's actually here, and it doesn't work for you. And you're tied in for a long time, and you have to factor that in. And that's a process. I've seen at least 5 deals in the last 2 years that have fallen by the wayside on the application process because of that one issue they found like today. So, all right. Any other questions? Great question, Gilbert. All right. Well, the questions that we had today, your panelists developed these questions themselves. I thought they were great. I've been off and on, I think all of us in one form or another have been on debt panels around here for a long time. I think this is the best debt panel we've had.
Ever.
Make sure you tell John Yocum that.
I will.
John, that's whatever. Thank you all for coming. Again, we got a few minutes, I think, before luncheon starts. If you got any questions for our panelists, please come up. They'll be happy to answer them. Thank you.
Thank you.